My name is James Lucky. I'm a trade journalist. Mike, in your presentation early on there, you had a fantastic slide showing a really diverse mix of energy sources to 2050, which I think was repeated also in Matthew's presentation. From that, what do you project is the baseload sources? What are going to be the ones that are going to constantly be there? Is it, judging from your slide there, it looks as though it's going to be mainly nuclear. Is that right?
Yes. Should go ahead and answer this right? Yeah. Yeah, thanks for the question. We do look at baseload towards 2050 as well, and within that specific scenario, nuclear and carbon capture and storage would be the technologies providing baseload. Just to add, I think there's probably an emerging body of evidence questioning the need for baseload electricity as well, and the fact that if you have flexible electricity systems with storage, interconnection, and some of the demand-side response that Matt mentioned, you might not need as much baseload as we originally thought you might need over these kind of timescales. That said, we do include it to 2050. Thanks.
One question to ask. I'm a civil engineer. I used to work with W.H. Atkins and have been involved with Sizewell B as well as previous nuclear power stations. Can the panel give me some light about why the Sizewell B technology could not be adapted to these present generation nuclear power stations, where Sizewell B has been shown to be perfectly safe? American design, pressure water type, but why could not be done, and we could save a lot of money and get into the nuclear steam that much quicker? Thank you.
You hear me about?
I'll take that one, because I'm a chartered civil engineer and I now work for Atkins, and I've spent most of my career in the nuclear industry. So the reactor technology they're building at Hinkley Point C, the EPR, is essentially a PWR with some extra bells and whistles on it. So it is effectively the same technology with extra safety features. So it's the same reactor technology, essentially, but designed by Areva rather than Westinghouse. It's still a PWR. Does that answer your question? No? If I knew that, I'd be a very rich man. Partly because of the sheer scale of the project, partly because we haven't done this since Sizewell. Also partly because of the lack of skill and the lack of supply chain in the UK, which we're effectively having to regrow and rebuild for Hinkley Point C and then the follow-on stations, hopefully at Wilva and perhaps up by Sellafield.
Correct me if I'm wrong, but didn't the UK bet on the wrong technology in terms of nuclear, and that's why the nuclear industry in the UK died? It wasn't that it was bad technologies, it just didn't match what the Americans and then the French copied, and that's partly why we're having to rely on international sources?
Sort of. Bet's maybe the wrong word, but yeah, essentially the UK had the choice of buying the technology from Westinghouse, from the Americans, or going with our own homegrown technology, which is AGRs, which uses gas to cool the reactor rather than water. And yeah, I mean, the essence of what you're saying is right, yeah. Yeah, we're the only country really that uses that kind of technology. All the kind of modern reactors are variants on water-cooled reactors.
Yeah, I mean, I think you raise a very good point because there's been such a difference with our nuclear program compared to what happened in France, where they have a huge fleet and they're all very, very similar, if not the same. It does trouble me a bit with Hinkley Point C that it is first of a kind and it is so expensive and it is going to take so long. I think there are a lot of lessons that could be learned there about how to do it cheaper for the next generation after that, not least because I think, you know, one of the wild cards we have to consider in terms of energy supply in 2050 is, will the utilities have the financial strength to actually deliver? Because they are ultimately beholden to their investors. And at the moment, you'd have to say the likes of EDF would be struggling because they have their own domestic concerns in terms of France's nuclear replacement program, which for them would probably look like a priority over our own.
Can I just...
Yeah, please, Matthew.
Can I speak? Yes, can I? May I? Just on that, the cost of nuclear, I did make the comment that I believe nuclear is a good option. Some slides that I didn't show are about the cost of inaction, the cost of us overshooting the Climate Change Act, of us not meeting 1.5 degrees. I don't know if you're familiar with the Nicholas Stern report, but he came up with an estimate of around £30 per ton for CO2 emissions, additional emissions in the atmosphere beyond that 2 degrees. If you add that up in terms of how much we overshoot by about 4 gigatons. That's hundreds of billions in cost, in damages, in additional flooding, in coastal erosion, sea level rise, drought, all over the world. So the amount of cost to the world of just the UK exceeding its emissions standards are far greater than our overseas development aid program, orders of magnitude more. The best thing we can do for the world is clean up our emissions. It's better than all the spending that we do on aid. So in terms of the question around nuclear or gas, CCGT with CCS, either one, I personally don't care. As long as we choose one and we do it, because that's going to cost us a heck of a lot less.
Jeff Beacon from the Pollution Tax Association. I've heard worries about, for a long time, not just the recent report about that comes out from people in Durham about the safety of nuclear power stations next to the sea, because we're going to get A, a lot of sea level rise, B, James Hansen suggests that if the Gulf Stream shuts down a bit, we're going to get enormous storms, and there's the mudslides from Norway that could cause tsunamis. And I've spoken to a few nuclear people, and I'm not quite sure whether the specifications they're putting forward for sea defences are quite good enough. What do you feel about it? And would Westinghouse's mini nukes that you could put inland be a rather better option?
Okay, so two-part question, really. So essentially the short answer is yes, existing nuclear sites have to demonstrate to the ONR, to the regulator, that they're able to withstand extreme climatic events that have a return period of 1 in 10,000 years.
Whose work are they relying on for the 10,000 years?
Who's fundamentally setting those standards?
The standards are set by the ONR, so they have their licensing requirements that the licensee for the site is required to meet, and the licensee, so EDF, for example, for Hinkley Point C, they draw on the entire UK supply chain.
So they're the ones we rely on for climate change?
I think we've seen from the presentations today that we don't really have much of a choice. I think I haven't seen any credible argument yet that says we can achieve our emissions targets without nuclear power. That might be unpopular with some people, but I think that's the harsh reality.
Should it be little ones?
Please.
Should it be little ones, though? Should it be little Westinghouse ones rather than these big seaborne ones?
Possibly.
That I think may cause a danger.
We've got to be a little bit careful about SMR technology. We've spent the last 50 years building bigger power stations because there are real economies of scale there. I think anyone who is sort of selling SMRs as the silver bullet that's going to solve all our problems maybe needs to temper their views. Like they may have a part to play. I think we've seen recently that Westinghouse actually have abandoned their SMR program because they don't see it as being economically viable at the moment.
Price isn't big enough.
I just want to say, you know, first of all, I hugely admire my colleagues either side of me who dare to sort of make predictions about 2050, because it's quite a big graveyard of energy forecasting for energy specialists. So, you know, I think they've done a great job. But, you know, in terms of SMRs, as I understand, they're at least 10 years away for commercial availability. So there's still quite a lot of work that has to be done there. You know, we shouldn't rule out some really extreme changes that might happen in energy technology in years to come. And, you know, if I was to be really speculative and irresponsible, you might want to look, because we're going so far out to 2050, you might want to look at space-based solar power. So as the cost of getting access to space goes down, then you can actually launch and recover a rocket. But while you're there, you can place a space-based solar power station. And that overcomes your basic shortcoming of solar, is that because when you put it in a sun-synchronous orbit, you can actually have power 24 hours a day, day and night. So, you know, that would be a huge, huge change. And there are people certainly working on that right now.
I was just going to come back in on Jeff's point on the sea level rises. I think, like Darren mentioned, the UK does have a very strong regulatory body, and I think it's world renowned for what it does in assessing nuclear reactors before they're installed. Alongside that, some colleagues at the Committee on Climate Change look at climate change adaptation issues and assess the risks of things like sea level rise to the UK's infrastructure, which also feeds into things like the National Infrastructure Commission, which is also looking alongside these risks.
Hello? Is this live? Yeah, it is live. Okay, I have to challenge this thing about it's only going to be nuclear power that will address climate change. The country that is most advanced in Europe in terms of going away from fossil fuels and so on is Germany. Germany, under Merkel, have abandoned nuclear power. Wasn't just a whim. They produced the Kick report. If anybody wants to know about the problems with nuclear power, get hold of a copy of the Kick report. Germany currently is producing 33% of their total energy needs through renewables. They've addressed the problem of the, you know, like the problem of interruption of supply because wind and daylight and whatever, through the Combi Kraftwerk projects. First one was 2007 to 2010, second one 2010 to 2013. In the first one, they showed that 36 alternative energy producers could work together as one nuclear power station and supply the needs of an area. In the second one, and these are big projects, Siemens and all sorts of the other big industrial people in Germany were involved. By 2013, they showed that the whole of Germany could have all its power needs met by renewable resources. Now, remember, we're including things like biomass, where with biomass, you can turn it on and turn it off pretty much instantaneously, okay? Which you can't with nuclear. It takes a long time to close down a nuclear power station and bring it back up again. Nuclear is a lot more expensive than these alternatives. And if you compare it to things like wind power, it's far more expensive. Okay? Nuclear has never actually realized its potential. I've studied it since 1970. I'm an energy consultant. It's just a technology that people are hoping will someday come right. The French are actually now decreasing their reliance on nuclear. It's crazy for us to go for unproven technologies like this.
I'll pick that. Interestingly, I like the statement, so what are we going to do? I'm really interested, and this is why I want a debate going, because that's a fabulous statement, and I have no drive. What are we going to do? We've heard an energy mix story. I'd love to hear a view.
Right. Quite simple, actually. What we do is we adopt a lot of the ideas that the Germans have used. When I go to Germany, which I do quite frequently, I go to energy days where the government encourages people to turn up to learn about insulating their houses. Incidentally, the Germans have insulated 3 million homes with 74% reduction in energy by 2013, so they're a lot more ahead of that than we are. So we must do the energy reduction side of it. Then we also have to do things like energy farms. In Germany, every 20th farm is, it might not already be, but it will become an energy farm. And all the local produce, slurry, green waste and whatever, goes to biomass. Okay, so the biomass is rising very steadily in Germany. Like us, they have big offshore wind and they're increasing that. Solar panels on houses everywhere in Germany. There's a, a huge preponderance of solar panels. Partly the reason the solar panels are there is because there's a bit of peer pressure nowadays. It used to be that somebody wanted the biggest and latest Mercedes in their drive. Now for Germans, they want more PV panels on their roof than their neighbours.
Fabulous. Fabulous. Thank you. Interestingly, team, so how does that play out? Matt, I'll come to you first. And how does this domestic power generation pit fit into this as well?
I was never pro-nuclear before I did this modelling exercise. The problem for me is the numbers just don't add up in terms of what you have to do in order to transition to a decarbonised state in the UK. You just don't have, you can't ramp up your alternatives quickly enough. You either have to go with nuclear or carbon capture and storage with gas turbine. The German experience, I'm sorry to say, they rely on interconnectors with other countries, from French nuclear energy. They also now having to build coal-fired power stations to deal with the intermittency. Now, you're going to be able to solve those problems eventually if you have a whole system across Europe that is interconnected and you get more wind and solar distribution across the whole of Europe. But in terms of the work we're doing in the UK and the transition of the UK to a decarbonised state, the numbers, I'm afraid, just don't add up in our modelling. But you could probably add some more to that.
Yeah, I mean, I work in the nuclear industry, so I do have a vested interest in the nuclear industry, but I'm, rather than being pro-nuclear, I think similar to Matt, I'm pro-evidence, and all the evidence tells me that I really don't think we can meet our decarbonisation targets without nuclear power. And don't forget, we're only really talking about electricity. So Germany, who you rightly said are the best performing country in Europe, are meeting a third of their electricity needs. So we need to meet 100% of our electricity needs, and then the same again for transport, and the same again for heating and industrial use. And I just can't see the numbers adding up to meet those targets through renewables alone. I'd be delighted if someone can prove me wrong, but I just can't see it.
Mike.
Just on the domestic point there that you raised, I think it's definitely, Germany has been a good example of consumers engaging with the energy transition, potentially more than the UK. The UK households, there's about 1 million of them currently with solar PV on their households, which is commendable, and they get paid by the government to do so. However, over the long term, it's not clear that that households would be able to meet all of their electricity demands with solar PV. Even if they added a battery or something like that, they'd still be dependent on the grid. And I think solar PV is probably the first wave of households engaging with this energy transition. What we need beyond this is households also engaging with energy efficiency, electric vehicles, electric low-carbon heating as well, in order to make sure that we do follow this path towards 2050.
Dan. Sorry, Matt, let Dan jump in first. And then.
Yeah, forgive me if I don't have such a rosy view of the German example. But it does seem to me that we are at this nexus. We are at this nexus of what the future looks like and how much power comes from the grid and how much power is generated within the distribution network and where the twain shall meet. And, you know, in terms of Germany, and you know, I know I spent a lot of time there, I like it very much, but they have had a big cost in air pollution in terms of diesel. I think ourselves, in terms of biomass, wood pellets, I don't think it's a particularly brilliant idea. And then, you know, they have strategic concerns over importing gas from Russia. And then, whilst a lot of consumers like to get engaged, I always remind myself, you know, I'm interested in energy, but I don't want to sort of Freudianly sort of impose it on everyone else. And I think there are lots of people out there who are not interested. You know, they just want to pay their bills, keep them as low as possible, and that's all they want to know.
Sorry, I am actually one of these people that have solar panels, but we also have all energy saving devices as well, and we can't use the amount of power we produce. We're exporting 75%. We've also got insulation. We charge up storage heaters in the daytime, that's our heating in the evening. We charge up the batteries on our products in the daytime, and of course, if I'm on my laptop, that's what I'm using in the evening. The only thing we use in the evening from the grid is a TV or the kettle or something, which is a super kettle, which you can again fill it up with water and then for like a couple of hours in the evening, it's just ticking over at 40 watts. So if everybody did that, you could have your low bills. You don't have to change your lifestyle, just your energy efficiency.
Matt, please.
The interesting thing is when you look at it from the national scale, things become a bit more difficult. So Oxfordshire, for instance, cannot take any more distributed solar. Its distribution network cannot handle it. They have to retrofit the distribution network. So the distribution network was built for big things, producing a lot of power and distributing it out. Fair enough, we've built it in the first place. We can change it over time, but there's going to be a certain amount of expense with that. In terms of your energy storage, so battery technologies, the problem with batteries is that they may be cost effective and the cost will come down with the gigafactory and all that. But if you look at it from the point of view of the energy return on investment, so how much energy you get back from what you put into building it in the first place, it's just not there at the moment.
It's all right.
Sorry?
We've had over half our investment back over 4 years already.
Yeah, that's in terms of cost, but in terms of the energy that's put into it. So if you put it on a global scale, it becomes what they call an energy vampire, because it's pulling more energy out of the system than it takes to create it in the first place. Solar panels used to be like that, but they're not anymore. It's not about cost, it's about energy. And at the moment, batteries don't have that positive effect on the global energy systems. There's other alternatives, ground thermal and stuff like that.
If we just make this the last bit on this, please.
So where you're saying that you need this and you need nuclear and things, then why can't we just start reducing the amount of fossil fuels and incorporating more of what we're producing? Because our 75% is going somewhere, but if you're saying it's not being used, why not?
Because the distribution network's not set up to use excess energy. It can't use it. You need energy storage for that. So you demand it when the sun's not shining. The peak is at the end of the day. And so it's about meeting peak is the problem.
Well, like I say, we don't use an awful lot of electricity in the dark.
No, that's fine. I think it's an interesting point around how do we manage, if we have this distributed domestic network, how do we manage and store that excess? Because the reality, as I see at the moment, is we have more people who will not go down that route because they will not find the £10,000 for that solar array or whatever it may be. And equally, they may not be in a place where they can do it. So it's an interesting dynamic that I think this market will flow through. But ultimately, we're not going to be ready. There are 55 million homes in the UK. We need something a bit faster than that.
Just a quick comment. I think that the nuclear lobby has sponsored this panel. It's horrible that EcoBuild event, we can hear these arguments. And also this panel conflicts the previous, because we had representatives from local distribution companies who said that they're now transitioning to the DSO model. And we just heard from the Oxford University academic that they are not able to do it. No, they said before, here in your position, they said that they can do it. Technically, they can absolutely do it, and they are transitioning in doing this. And now you say, if I understood well, that no, we need Hinkley. So there is a total conflict of what you said and what the previous people said. So I'm totally with the other member of the audience who talked about the solar PV panels. And also the other thing is that I'm totally surprised with the first Mike Hemsley, you said, I think you're name right. You work for a governmental body, right? I thought that the nuclear and the offshore wind lobby have paid a lot of money to affect the government opinions, but now it's very obvious because you said that the base load in 2050 is going to be from nuclear and the offshore wind, and we have the electricity market reform, which absolutely supports this vision and excludes the decentralized model that other countries in Europe, it doesn't matter if it's Germany or other countries, don't be stuck up about the name of the country, but there is a new movement. And you don't support it, you don't embrace this movement. So I'm absolutely in shock, actually. And I had to check a couple of times my notes if my English was good, but my understanding is perfect, that you support nuclear and offshore wind while the whole of the world is going towards another model. I'm really shocked that EcoBuild supports this view, really.
Sorry. Interestingly, this is a debate. And the whole purpose of this is to bring out both sides. So EcoBuild is supporting the debate because there is no answer. However, Mike, I'm going to come to you.
Thanks. Yeah, I don't support any particular technology. And indeed, I hoped what I presented there was trying to be a technology agnostic view of the future. And when the gentleman did ask the question on nuclear, I said it was one scenario for 2050, which involved nuclear as a baseload technology. We do a lot of cost analysis, and a lot of that cost analysis comes out as having nuclear as a low-cost option long-term in the UK. That said, if nuclear wasn't a low-cost option in the UK, then we'd have to consider another option. And regarding the point on flexibility, I don't think we've really had an opportunity to fully talk about flexibility today, and I don't think that really was the subject at hand. I think it is very important that the electricity system changes over the next 15 years to be able to accommodate things like your excess solar PV generation. Indeed, the UK electricity system of the last 5 years is already struggling to adapt to that, and we have a fraction of the potential output we could have from households on this. And there's a lot of work going on now at government level and at Ofgem level in order to try and design the future electricity system so that we're not wasting that energy and we can put it to good use. That said, we can't rule out a centralized generation model for the future, and we can't rule out a decentralized either. We need to consider all of these options towards 2050. And I'd hope that what I presented did kind of cover that off, but I guess not.
Dan.
Look, what is it about the energy industry? Sometimes I think everyone hates everyone, and everyone has the perfect solution, and all the others are terrible. But you know, really, to answer your point, sir, it does seem to me that we really don't know the future, and it would be a huge mistake that would be very difficult to measure if we were to know for a fact, based on current linear trends, when actually we seem to be going in non-linear direction, and you know, really received opinion gets turned upside down. I mean, remember when there was a consensus for staying in the European Union, or any number of things. And I think, you know, we are accelerating in this world, and I am excited about the future of energy technology. I think we're going into a fantastic, innovative age, and I think it will be software-driven. And I think that what's so interesting is how mass production in countries like China that has brought down the cost of things like solar panels, but at the same time, it's still China that are driving up emissions. So you know, we can look at this any way we want, but I do think in the long run, we are going to be living better, cleaner lives and safer ones too.
Can I change the topic slightly?
Please
here?
Do.
I'm asking. If the panel could give some clarity, you know, biomass has been mentioned as one of the energy mix that is helping decarbonization. Can you give me some clarity on the carbon intensity of biomass? Because there's been quite a few differing options in the media recently.
Who'd like to pick that? Please, Darren.
It's not my particular area of expertise, but from what I read, it's sort of touch and go, really, as to whether or not you actually get more CO2 out of burning biomass than you do from using it as a fuel because of the energy intensity and actually creating the fuel. You might have a bit of view on that.
It's one of the options in terms of negative emissions technology, one of the ones that most of the IPCC have in their models for when we actually meet the 2 degrees target. A lot of those models have a lot amount of what they call BECCS, which is biomass with carbon capture and storage. There are options that I have seen, one in terms of biochar, which is you can get heat out of biomass at a certain temperature, a certain pressure. You don't give off CO2 emissions, you produce char, and then you put that char in the ground and mix it into the soil, and it becomes an organic fertilizer. Amazing solution. I thought, my God, we've found the solution. Unfortunately, it requires small-scale biochar operations the world over to be able to solve that. Knowing myself, I'm not a big believer in behavioural change. I can't see the world going backwards away from technology towards something that is more homespun, and I'm sorry to be saying this, that I'm as green as they come, to be honest with you. I am actually pretty green, but I'm also into evidence-based. And on a national scale, which is where I operate, some of these technologies, biomass, can't deliver what you need it to deliver. Biofuels, a lot of it is taking up at the moment corn and maize in the States. They're using that for biofuels, but that's causing problems in markets in third world countries for food, for people. So there's costs with everything. Tidal can produce base load. Tidal's fantastic, but then there's implications on bird and fish life, and everything comes at a cost. And so hopefully what we're doing, and maybe I represent the fragile academic these days, but we are trying to assess all these different possibilities. And I've got to say, it's at a national scale, so that is kind of the difference in terms of looking at the issue from a smaller scale point of view.
I think this has been an absolutely fabulous session, because we have got such a diverse set of views and we all have an impact. And it's really interesting, and I absolutely take the piece. What are you all going to do when you go home tonight? Because I need to go and buy some energy-saving light bulbs for a start of a 10. Because I think the reality is, you reduce our use, and then the mix will then be determined. And I am genuinely fascinated. I can't wait to see this space solar power station. I think this is just amazing. Panel, thank you. Fabulous.